Further debate. I recognize the member for York Centre.
Thank you, Speaker, and good morning. Speaker, 10 days ago, the head of Ontario's science table said that we need 2 weeks to flatten the curve. Almost 20 months later, after the longest and harshest lockdown in the world and the longest school closure in the world, passports which Ontarians are supposed to present to strangers to get a bowl of soup at Tim Hortons, when doctors, nurses, first responders, and everyone else is coerced into a medical procedure or lose their job, after we've done what the government has asked of us and 90% of us are vaccinated, after all of that, we go back to where we were 20 months ago for 2 more weeks to flatten the curve. And now, the government needs to extend the emergency orders by another 4 months. Now, what does that tell us, Speaker? It tells us that they were wrong about everything. They were wrong about the lockdown and the effect of the lockdown. They attribute cases to going down because of the lockdown, but miraculously, the pattern is the same. Every time we approach May, cases go down. It's not lockdown, it's seasonality. The governor of California, a big purveyor of lockdowns, admitted a couple of days ago that it's seasonality. And it was never about the strategy or how many people get COVID. It should have been about who gets COVID, because the illness is so highly transmissible. You see, on October 15th, Statistics Canada confirmed that more than 80% of everyone who regretfully died from COVID died in a long-term care home. The average age is on par with life expectancy and one or more comorbidities. Now, that doesn't mean that we should take COVID lightly or leave the vulnerable people destitute. No. We need to protect long-term care homes. We need to protect the frail and elderly. We need to look at evidence objectively and the mass hysteria and respond to the actual crisis before us. The groupthink, the politically correct narrative, fortified by cancel culture, led to the greatest policy error of our lifetime, and it is now leading to segregation of a whole group of people. Look at the evidence, Speaker. We now have 2 years, and we're still behaving as if it's March or April 2020. But it's this government that kept feeding the fear-mongering narrative to justify its own actions. Here's what happened. The Premier was late to the game on March 17, 2020. He was already accused of being a COVID denier because on March 12, 2020, he told everyone to go and enjoy their vacation. So after the weekend, his advisors probably got together and they decided that they're going to get ahead of it. And they're never going to deviate from what public health says. To be clear, I think Premier Ford himself disagrees with his own government policy. The Premier agrees with me, and so do most government members. This is all a show. All of this is a show. Except they do not have the courage to admit it, and they allow the catastrophe to go on. Remember what the Premier said on March 13, 2021. He was at Centennial College, and he said, quote, "No politician will disagree with a medical officer. Disagreeing with a medical officer is like tying a noose around your neck and going off a bridge. I'm telling you the truth. It's not going to happen." Close quote. You see, the Premier forgot who he was talking to at that moment. He thought he was talking to his caucus or his cabinet. He forgot he was talking to the media. And he told everyone what he really thought, that not following the insane course that we were on may amount to a political disaster for him. And that tells you everything you need to know about what's happening here today. It's not about COVID. It's not about healthcare. It's not about keeping people safe. It's about politics. That quote was also very demeaning and insensitive towards anyone that suffered mental health anguish as a result of the pandemic and the lockdowns and the families of those that self-harmed. Every day, this government looks at opinion polling, and this is where the polling led them to. They created all this fear-mongering, and now they have to respond to it. They also have to justify their actions, so they have to feed more fear. Now they can't retreat from it. They are stuck. Instead of calling out public health, they decided to take a back seat. But how did they not make the distinction with long-term care homes and allow for this catastrophe to unfold? Why did more people die in the second wave in long-term care homes than in the first wave? All of this, Speaker, is a distraction because of their failure to protect long-term care, because of the fundamental unwillingness by public health, the science table, and the celebrity doctors to admit that they were wrong. public health was wrong about everything. Even when the science evolved, public health continued to deny science. Let's look at some examples. We understood very early on that there is no transmission on surfaces. But public health has not acknowledged that until recently, and the obsessive cleaning at my Metro grocery store continues. They claim that it's a droplet virus. That's one thing I agree with my buddy David Fishman. It's not droplet, it's aerosol. The New York Times had a piece on this in the summer of 2020. We still can't admit that it's not a droplet virus. Because acknowledging that distinction will make so much of what we've done for the last 2 years completely absurd. We had evidence that it's not droplet when the restaurants opened in New York in spring 2020. People were getting COVID through the ventilation, but they continued to suggest that it's droplet. As late as last week, finally Dr. Tam admitted last week that it's not droplet. It took them 2 years. Until 2 weeks ago, we had restrictions outdoors. Why? Why this theater of the absurd? We know that the virus does not transmit outdoors, but they prohibit gatherings. The government cannot point to a single example of an outbreak outdoors, not one, and yet we denied gatherings, assembly, and expression. People were getting arrested for holding a Canadian flag at Dundas Square because they wanted their kid back in school or because they wanted to open their shop, Speaker. They claimed that they wanted to reduce mobility. Remember, we're talking about mobility. They were going to implement a police state on April 16th, but 34 out of 35 police forces in the province said no. God bless their hearts. But then they were wrong about mobility, because as mobility increased into the spring and summer, cases decreased. But the talk about mobility by public health still went on. For 2 years, they refused to utter the words natural immunity. Natural immunity is the first principle of immunology. But we're firing nurses and paramedics who had COVID because of cancel culture that the premier has succumbed to, because he wants to be loved and reelected. Millions of lives are broken, Speaker. Millions of families are broken. The goalpost keeps moving every month for the last 20 months. Public health knew of resistant variants as early as November 2020. Moderna said on January 12th, that their shot is only good for a year. Pfizer was talking about a booster about a year ago, but public health continued to insist that we need to reach herd immunity. How are you going to reach herd immunity with a leaky vaccine? How are we going to reach herd immunity when the efficacy wanes 6 to 8 months, and yet the government continues to deny science? Which is why now it needs 2 more weeks to flatten the curve and 4 more months of emergency orders. But despite this policy of destruction, they're coming back for more. They want an ability to reimpose lockdowns, to reimpose restrictions without any limitations, without coming back to Parliament and having a debate. Does it sound right to anyone, conceptually, that we should have emergency orders without a declaration of a state of emergency? If they want emergency orders, if they believe that there's an emergency, or if they require extraordinary action that will only be available through emergency orders, then they should declare a state of emergency. They should put their money where their mouth is. Instead, they have a government-controlled committee which rubber stamps everything the Minister of Health and the Solicitor General puts before it. They're not even allowed to ask questions, government members. They have staffers out of university writing down questions for them that they're permitted to ask. I don't even know what it is they do here, and why don't they stand up for their constituents? But instead, they're suffocating small business, suffocating hospitals, suffocating school boards, and suffocating children, literally and figuratively. The greatest denial of science is the failure to acknowledge that thankfully and statistically that kids are almost at no risk. We should celebrate that. We should shout it from the rooftops, but instead we're scaring children. Stay away from Jenny. If you play with Jenny, you'll get the virus and grandma will die. That's the generation we just raised. That is the catastrophe we caused to Ontario's children when we put them in boxes in the schoolyard and behind plexiglass, in masks for 8 hours. I was joking with someone the other day, I was out for dinner this weekend, not a physically distant dinner, that we should substitute all the classroom tables with restaurant tables, because that way it's probably safe and the kids should be able to take off their masks and even talk while they eat. How come the adults are allowed to go out for dinner, sit down, take off the masks, eat and talk, no physical distancing, but kids who are known to transmit less, who are statistically at almost no risk, are not allowed to take off the mask, are not when they sit at the desk, are not allowed to talk during lunch? Speaker, none of this makes any sense. None of it ever did. A smart lawyer taught me once for life, and it served me very well, that if it doesn't make sense, it probably doesn't work. Maybe from Sault Ste. Marie should return calls to his constituents instead of heckling me. Here's what it is. Here's what it is. It's a respiratory virus, Speaker. It's dangerous. For anyone that wants to understand COVID, here's my take on COVID. It's dangerous to folks at end of life, especially with comorbidities. It's very transmissible, and it may be risky to folks with metabolic conditions, particularly diabetes. But it's no cause to reorder society, to lock down people, to close schools, or shut down our businesses. We have never done that before. I know we don't even talk about businesses because, you know, the Conservatives are the new NDP now. They're the party of yes, the party that campaigned on efficiencies and gravy trains are now the party of yes. How many lives, how many businesses have been shuttered by virtue of these emergency orders? According to the CFIB, Speaker, an average business took on $170,000 worth of COVID-related debt. And this is despite the fact that they were not responsible for much of the spread. You see, most of the spread is actually happening within government-run institutions. Why can't we leave kids alone and leave small business alone? The saddest part, Speaker, is all of this was foreseeable. Lockdown is deadlier than COVID. I wrote that a year ago, which is why I now sit on this side of the House. Finally, the Minister of Health admitted yesterday that people died from related causes other than COVID. And the evidence against them is piling up. Lockdown is deadlier than COVID. I know that most members on the other side know it. The Premier knows it. I think the media is coming around to it. The Liberals play pretend. Some dippers get it. But everyone here is still pretending. Yes, this is on all of us. Look at the Toronto Star. Let's look at evidence. The increase in overdose. The member from Sault Ste. Marie has a crisis in his riding and he's heckling me over overdose. Shame on him. The increase in overdose alone in people under 50 is more than double than all those that passed away from COVID. Look at Statistics Canada this year on excess mortality last year. During some periods, excess mortality is 3-1 on other causes versus COVID. Don't bury your head in the sand. Go look at the evidence. We have a mental health catastrophe, especially in pediatric mental health. We've always had hallway health care, but now CHEO and McMaster Children's Hospital don't have any pediatric mental health beds left. 250,000 surgeries were postponed. How many people are going to die as a result of that? We deserve an answer. 1 million cancer screenings were missed. How many people will die because they were diagnosed late? Just under a year ago, when I warned the government about the mental health catastrophe, about the drastic increase in overdose, and the pending tsunami of cancer that Princess Margaret was warning about, I was accused of misinformation and removed from caucus. Instead of recognizing that we're on a collision course with an iceberg, the government House leader decided to flex his muscle. Deputy leader of the NDP, the only thing the NDP had to say in response to me sounding the alarm was that we need to recall Parliament a month early so they can take away my committee chair so I make $1,000 less for the following month. That's what the opposition thinks about children who are self-harming, the human catastrophe of overdose that is gripping their own ridings. COVID is real and it can be deadly. Two very close people in my life lost a family member to COVID. It breaks my heart. But that doesn't change the objective evidence that lockdown is deadlier than COVID. If the point is to save lives, then we're not saving any lives. We're costing and harming lives. This motion will cost lives. I'd like to conclude with portions of an article cited by the CBC last Sunday by Dr. Sheila Singh, a pediatric neurosurgeon for McMaster's Children's Hospital in Hamilton. Dr. Singh published an article in Brighter World on October 5, 2021, and among other things, she writes as follows, all right? This is a Hamilton brain surgeon, a pediatric surgeon. Quote, and I'm editing some. Many aggressive brain cancers occur before the age of 5 and difficult to diagnose in young children. Very often in the last year or so, I've seen children for the first time when they've already reached the end stage of brain cancer. These are children whose lives we could have saved if diagnosed 6 months earlier. Sometimes families were too reluctant to take their children to take them to see their family physician, or regular care was only accessible through appointments. We're so much less information, virtual appointments, where so much less information is available to the clinician. This includes the vital observation that can only come from a physical exam. The fear and destruction generated by our approach to the pandemic drowned out other concerns with dreadful consequences, says the doctor from Hamilton. Sadly, I'm certain that these preventable deaths are happening throughout the healthcare system, among children and adults alike. Patients have delayed seeking diagnosis and treatment because they were more afraid of the virus than whatever else was happening. My colleagues talk about adult patients skipping diagnostic procedures like colonoscopies, ignore chest pains, or fail to investigate other serious concerns. Speakers, we appear to be emerging from, and she says, as we appear to be emerging from the worst stages of the pandemic, I'm bracing myself to see more children with advanced terminal cancer, knowing they could have lived if not for this well-meaning but misguided approach. I want to be very clear, Mr. Speaker. These cancer deaths, these children, these cancer deaths resulting from late diagnosis are the fault of this government. This government, this premier, this health minister, this solicitor general are responsible for every one of these children. And the opposition and the independent liberals who have no courage to stand up for the vulnerable, for the minorities, for the children, like, just like they have no courage to stand up against the segregation that is now happening in our province, they are too responsible for the catastrophe that this motion seeks to extend. It's important to note that Dr. Singh pleads for an increase for more inpatient care, old-fashioned care, when a doctor can have a good look and feel, particularly with patients that don't communicate well, like children. And yet the Minister of Health releases a nonsensical survey that suggests that patients and doctors like virtual care. It's the main complaint I get in my constituency office. I want to be able to see a doctor in person. There should be an option to see a doctor in person. Speaker, more and more people are realizing the gravity of the disaster caused by this government and this pandemic. I wish I was wrong in my letter to the Premier of January 15th, but I was right. Lockdown is deadlier than COVID. Any MPP with a working cell phone would have known that a year ago, and a lot of MPPs are now waking up in this house. Don't look away. I can see all of you, and the public can see all of you. And yesterday, the Minister of Health finally admitted that people died from other causes, and we're going to dig down and get to the bottom of it. I just surely hope that the truth will prevail. It's important that it does, or else groupthink and cancel culture will drive the response during the next pandemic or any other issue that we're dealing with. Labor, healthcare, the environment, our finances. We should entertain opinion instead of censoring them or punishing well-meaning professionals who tender opinion. But I hope the truth will prevail, although there are either two ways that this is going to end. Either the narrative will continue crumbling down and the truth will prevail and everyone's going to be held accountable, or the narrative will reinforce itself with censorship and misinformation. Of course, government members want this narrative to stick for their re-election purposes. It's very unfortunate that the Conservative Party, which used to stand on principle, on good government, on doing the right thing, even if it was the unpopular thing, is now the party of yes. Please withdraw this motion. Protect long-term care, build hospital capacity, and leave Ontarians alone. Going back to normal is the best thing we can do for the healthcare of Ontarians. Thank you, Speaker.